Maharaj, there is a question from Kanika Didi, Gupta Govardhan, and also Sahadev Prabhu offers his dandavats because he was very helpful. He provided us with the original record of Guru Maharaj's talk.
A recording,
yeah. So I just read a quote.
Where is he right now?
I don't know. I didn't ask
him. Okay.
Maybe somebody knows. So the quote is the part from that talk recorded in 1982. The faith that such things are existent, all venerable sight. The whole sight is venerable, such things exist. Such firm faith, that is enough. Others will come from them, the land of guardian. They are our well-wishers. How much I can love myself, my interest. How can love a child? How can the child know to love him, his mother, his father, his guardian? They love the child more than the child can discriminate and love himself. So we must have faith in the guardian and the higher conception of the Prem, that there is such consideration, there is affection, there is judgment, there is grace, mercy, the land of my guardian. That is enough to have real faith, not an imaginary philosophic faith, but practical. Theoretical or philosophical understanding won't do. So the question is, it is a request to explain, to expand on the idea of this statement of Guru Maharaj. Thank you.
From time to time, Srila Guru Maharaj is reminding us, informing us, and that the upper world, the spiritual world, the world of our guardians, of Krishna consciousness, that it is real and substantial. Because there is a tendency on our part, we're so riveted to the mundane and the mundane world, the temporary world. We think this is the substantial place because, you know, it's made out of earth, you know, bhumi rupo analova, earth, water, fire, things you can stand on, touch, feel, they have weight, breath, dimension, etc. We think this is the real world. Then we hear about Krishna consciousness and we can think that's like a theoretical world. This is the real world we live in, and how much all of this is true, what we're hearing, how much it can be relied upon, we're doubtful. This is the plight of a neophyte devotee, to be honest and candid. We're hearing things, so we think that is imaginary. When the people hear about Puranic legends and story, they think like, oh, you mean Hindu mythology, right? But they're very happy to embrace the mythology of Hollywood or of this, that, or the other, that they're get all excited about. But anyway, story. We're told the, you know, fiction. Some say, if you want to tell the truth, write fiction. Seems like some sort of an oxymoron. Right? But quote variously attributed to Picasso or any other is that, you know, art is a lie that tells the truth. What it means in that statement is that if in the end you receive truth or become aware of the truth, embrace the concept of truth, the medium through which it came to you, whether that is objectively, historically accurate is irrelevant. And again, this requires a new type of thinking or more careful thought. Sometimes it occurs to me that the Western world generally tend to be the world of like rationalist, empiric thinkers. This is the the hallmark of Western philosophy: rationalism, empiric observation, all of these sort of things. So I found it interesting that people with educated in the Western line of thought, how much they admire Bhagavad Gita. And years ago in ISKCON, to promote Bhagavad Gita, the book, they started searching for any quotes by people in the Western world who were appreciating it. They even made a poster showing, Emerson, Thoreau, Whitman, Schopenhauer, and others. And, quoting, one of the favorite quotes was from Thoreau at Walden Pond, where he's living in nature by himself for a couple of years to see what that would be like to live with no one. And he said, it's noteworthy. He says, in the morning, means every morning when he says, because in the morning, what do you do when you get up in the morning? You bathe. So he said, in the morning, I bathe my intellect and the stupendous and cosmogonal glory of the Bhagavad Gita. He's saying, as people get up in the morning, they take a bath. I get up in the morning and I bathe my intellect in the Bhagavad Gita. So it means Thoreau must have known something. He gets some credit for this. And he said, in comparison with which, our modern literature seems trivial and puny by comparison, what we've got. So that's one example. And there's so many others. But what I found interesting is a side point that none of them question the method of delivery. The general name, one of the names given, we say, Shabda Brahma, spiritual sound. In other words, Omnaya, Omni, like in Bhaktivinoda's Dasmul, Omnaya Prahatattvam, Harim Iha Paramam, Sarvashaktim Rasabdim. So he starts with Omni, revealed truth, means descending truth. It's coming from the upper world, descending into this world. So here, the method of descent, I found interesting. These so-called rational thinkers, empiric thinkers, they don't challenge the method. And I was wondering, why? Why not? We know from the beginning, what we hear there, it says, Dhritarashtra uvacha, what does he do? He asks Sanjay, what did my sons and the sons of Pandu do when they assembled on the battlefield of Dharmakshetra, Kurukshetra, etc.? And so this Sanjay, admittedly, by what's presented in the text, he's not there. It's not that Dhritarashtra is saying, you were there, and now, this is something that happened in the past. Tell me what happened. No, he's saying, you have a living experience. That means by, as we find out in the end, he says, Vyasa Prashada Shrutavan, by the mercy of Vyas, I heard this divine conversation. He doesn't say, well, Arjuna's chariot was here and the other, and then I was like on another chariot. No, he doesn't say that. So he's admitting that he wasn't there physically, objectively, But what he's saying is, Vyasa Prashada, by the mercy of Vyas, I got some divine vision. And Dhritarashtra saying, and what happened? What did you hear? What did you see? And then he presents Bhagavad Gita, right? That Krishna said this, Arjuna said that, the back and forth, right, of Krishna and Arjuna. It's all from the mouth of Sanjay, who by his own admission is not there. I'm trying to, emphasize this point. Objectively speaking, the Bhagavad Gita, what we know of Bhagavad Gita, is spoken by someone who was not there. So then you would think these rational people, empiric-based, observers would say, well, how can he be reliable? He wasn't even there. How did he get? Oh, he had some sort of a divine vision? This stuff would be mocked normally, right? They would dismiss out of hand, like, oh, is he some sort of trance channeler, a medium? But I think there's a good explanation for why they do not, that no one has brought this up or made this accusation or challenged it in this way. And what it is, the overwhelming spiritual quality of the substance of Bhagavad Gita, that cannot be denied. So the method of transmission from, we will say, it's wonderful. He's saying, by the mercy of Vyas, I got this. Vision or realization, revelation. We will praise that. But what I'm saying, they can't find fault with it because of the overwhelming quality of the spiritual substance of Bhagavad Gita. It's undeniable, it's unmistakable. Even if people have some other agenda, they're not promoting devotion to Krishna, they're promoting anything and everything but devotion to Krishna. But what they find there is so overwhelming substantially that they're attracted to it. On some level, it resonates within them. So what is that principle? Again, so what is true subjectively, it doesn't have to be objectively verifiable. It's another type of truth. We're not talking about, even in this world, it's so-called objective reality is, it's a consensus among objective observers, like kilometers or miles. There's no such thing. They don't exist. I'm here to tell you that now. There's no such thing as a kilometer or a mile. It's just something we agreed upon with one another for the sake of mundane measurement. We found it convenient, so we made up something. We said 1,000 of these equals one of those. It's all right, it's a good system when you're in the world of measurement. It's not helpful when you're trying to dealing with the immeasurable world, the Vaikuntha world, which by definition is beyond mundane measurement. So when we say, well, when we use our mundane system of measuring, we're coming up short, empty, zero. We can't verify these things. That's correct. It's non-verifiable by that method, but it is by another method. And what we told Bhaktivinoda Dasmo, Amnaya Prahat Tattvam, revealed truth, descending knowledge. When the person challenged Guru Maharaj by saying, if the infinite can be known by the finite, it's not infinite. Guru Maharaj's immediate retort was, if the infinite cannot make himself known to the finite, he's not infinite. And he said, and I shook his hand and left. And the man went like, oh, you know, like, that's something to consider. That's, he understood. Guru Maharaj actually not only answered his question, but surpassed his expectation. He thought what he said was unchallengeable. But Guru Maharaj responded, because we could say, just for the sake of being generous or exploring this subject, and he said, if the finite can know the infinite, it's not infinite. It's half true. By finite means, you cannot know what is infinite. Right? This happens to us repeatedly. I remember in school, in mathematics, one of the few times when I was actually paying attention, that they said, like, whenever I heard the word infinity, I liked that. That caught my attention. And they're going like, so these numbers right here, you're like falling asleep. And then they go, but because they go on infinitely, like pi, I think pi day was the other day. So they say, but, so because it keeps going on infinitely, we put this line here at the top that stands for ad infinitum. And I thought, well, that's interesting. But there are many different versions of this. They're saying at a certain point, it's beyond human comprehension. Right? And just as we see here, human beings have different levels of comprehension. There are the Einsteins, the Stephen Hawkings of the world, and there are other type of people. Right? So, but still, that man's point was, if the finite can know the infinite, that's not infinite. That's not infinity. It's just a very extensive version of finite. So we hear those great scientists, generally they have some humility. Einstein, Newton in particular, they're, when everyone else is praising them, that no one, you know everything, you're the, like I say about Newton, they say, you're the Einstein of your day. Okay. Anyway, you understand the point. They're saying, you're so brilliant. And what is he saying? No, like, what I know, and this is why it's a statement of humility, he's saying, what did he say? Like a child counting, grains of sand on the shore of the ocean of truth. So he's showing some humility in dealing with the infinite, if one has a proper concept of it. So the man was saying, if the finite can know the infinite, that's not the infinite. It's just an extended version of the finite that's beyond the conception of most finite people. But Guru Maharaj's response is so perfect, and it is the basis for theistic culture. If the infinite cannot make itself known to the finite, then he's not infinite. It's his infinite capacity to do so. So it won't, what will be the method? It'll be revelation, revealed truth, because the infinite is beyond finite comprehension. It cannot be a empiric method of observation or a step-by-step approach, just revelation, right? Like we're told, Saraswati Thakur's example, which seems like a modified version of the Socrates example, saying a man who's born in a dungeon. Right? Remember, in a dungeon, there are no windows. So born in a dungeon. How do you see things there? What's the illumination in a dungeon? By a candle or a torch. So a friend from outside the dungeon comes and says, starts speaking about the sun, says, I'd like to show you the sun. The man who's lived his whole life in a dungeon says, let me grab a torch so we can see it. And I say, no, you don't understand. You don't need a torch to see the sun. Now in his world, and this is a significant part of the example, he's saying, what are you, crazy? You're a fool. What can be seen without the aid of a torch? So what can be known without mathematics that can't be expressed in a mathematical formula like Descartes? thinking, but not that he was an atheist, but he's saying like, anything that's true can be expressed in a mathematical formula. So then what's the mathematical formula for beauty? What's the mathematical formula for funny? Right. What's the algorithm for funny? Oh yeah, whenever we do this algorithm, everybody laughs. No, if they would be selling that if they had it. There is no such thing, because it comes down to interpretation. Beauty is in the eye of the beholder. Humor is in the eye, or in the, wherever. Where is humor located? Oh, we don't know, I forgot. What's the mathematical formula for beauty? They, every now and then they do this, they like take these beautiful women and put their face in half and say, look, it's not the same on both sides. And if you took this side and added to that side, they're no longer pretty. That's interesting. Many things. So there, what it tells us is it's not rational. Beauty is not rational. And if in that sense you mean to say that it's irrational, then that which is irrational is not necessarily bad. There may be a plane where what is irrational, or meaning beyond what is rational, is something extraordinary. Maybe even spiritual or infinite. So Rupa Goswami is actually dealing with the same thing in his slokas, what is expressed by Guru Maharaj, when he says, Atak Sri Krishna Namari Nabhavye Graham Indriye. Remember, it's Rupa Goswami speaking, why it's so significant. And he's saying, Sri Krishna Namadi means the name of Krishna. But Nam also means sound. Keep, bear that in mind. Nam Adi means the name, the form of Krishna. Then comes guna, the qualities of Krishna. At last, lila, the pastimes of Krishna. He's saying all of these things are what? Atak Sri Krishna Namadi na bhavyed grahyam indriye. Grahyam means like grasp, but in the sense of comprehend or understand. He's saying they're beyond the grasp of the senses. And the senses include the mind. There's the seeing, hearing, tasting, touching, smelling, feeling, those senses, sometimes called the working senses, instrumentals, but the mind is also a sense. So what is he, this is interesting. So he's saying this name of Krishna, it's not that the ear can hear the name of Krishna, that the eye can see the form of Krishna. So then one can say, then what are we doing by vibrating the name of Krishna and presenting ourselves to for the darshan of the deity? Guru Maharaj again will point to the descending truth. What is descending through Guru and Vaishnava, that Krishna Nam that comes to us, and the Krishna conception touches the heart, influences the heart. That heart has some capacity to vibrate Krishna Nam. The heart under the influence of Sadhu, Shastra, Guru, and Vaishnava can vibrate Krishna Nam, can conceive the form of Krishna, can appreciate the qualities of Krishna, can enter into the pastimes of Krishna. All of this in one line, right? Implied by one line. But he's saying, so, but the first part, and how that is all that possible? Sevan muke hijavaro shayameva spurtida. Through service. Right? People wandering in the world of exploitation, they think merely by exposing themselves to the visuals, auditory sound, the visuals of Krishna consciousness, that they will have some substantial Krishna realization or revelation. It's not true. It's one of the flaws of Prakriti Sahajism. Therefore, the necessity of connecting with Krishna's agent, the primary method of the infinite revealing himself in this world. So he says, when there's a service current, just as in all of these illuminating, what are they, lights, right? The same apparatus that's there, remove the electricity, and I'm not praying for that, but if you take away the electricity, there's just darkness, right? Connected to an electric current, and the same apparatus is giving illumination. That's what he's saying. The namakar bahivai bata namukabunoi, just the vibration of that Krishna by the tongue and the ears, right? This is not the name of Krishna. There has to be the serving current there. So anyway, back to the point, the man in the dungeon. So he's saying, what can be seen without the aid of a torch? So what can be understood without logic, mathematics, rational thought? And the response is that, no, you don't understand the nature of the sun. You don't need that torch to illumine the sun. The sun is self-luminous. So you don't need logic, rationale, etc. to give illumination to divinity. He's self-revealing. They may have their place in helping us transition from the world that we're in at present, but they're not necessary. So Guru Maharaj's response, the infinite revealing itself to the finite. But it's a gradual transition. So as Guru Maharaj told, in the beginning, when he was telling me about all risk and no gain, for example, he mentioned first the expression, he said, we've heard the expression, there's no risk, no gain. And I thought of that and with regard to my own life, and I thought, yes, the former position I was in, I risked all of that to take shelter of you, and now I feel like I've gained everything. So I thought, this no risk, no gain proposition, I understand very well. And I was very happy, smiling, and like pleased with myself, you could say. And Guru Maharaj, I didn't know where this was going. I didn't know, as Gurudev would say, Guru Maharaj, when he sets up like trenches of argument, so, and as you come, you will fall in one of those. So I'm saying, yes, no, really, I understand, you know, I'm really happy. And Guru Maharaj said, but there is another plane, all risk and no gain. Are you ready for that? And as I sat there smiling from the previous statement, then I started thinking, I'd never heard this before. All risk and no gain. And then the smile left my face. And now I looked bewildered, a little confused, and I was thinking. And now Guru Maharaj was smiling. Seeing me bewildered, now he realized he got me. And he said, yes, all risk and no gain. Are you ready for that? And I couldn't think to say yes or, and Guru Maharaj said, that is the position of the Brajagopis. They're risking everything with no concept of gaining anything. They're not trying to get something from Krishna. Therefore, as we just heard in the appearance of Mahaprabhu, expressed as, there is no fault in the gopis' love for Krishna as there is in this world. Right? Because everything in this world is self-motivated. Even so-called parental love, filial love, everything. It's always self-motivated. And here we're being told, the gopis' love for Krishna, it doesn't have this sort of fault. It's pure. Right? It says, whatever they do is for Krishna, right? Including decorating themselves, making themselves look beautiful, etc. So it doesn't, Atmendriya Priti Itadari Premanam Bolikam Itabolikam. Krishnendriya Priti Itadari Premanam. What's done? Atmendriya means for the satisfaction of my own senses, lust. Krishnendriya, for the satisfaction of Krishna's senses, Prem. And Guru Maharaj is visual, his gravity, you know, North Pole, South Pole, right? Diametrically, that's the word. Diametrically opposed. So he's saying this is the gopi standard. See, you perceiving your self-benefit, you risked everything. And now you're very happy with what you got. That's not their motivation. Is thinking how much they'll gain by giving themselves to Krishna. That would be a fault. Their only concern is the happiness of Krishna. And this, from our present position, is almost inconceivable, that someone can really, truly be like that. We can see in this world, well, the closest thing is the mother's love for a child. And I'm not going to sit here and speak against mothers and motherhood. Because I won't be popular after that. But at the same time, spoiler alert, but there's also self-motivation. The child's giving so much pleasure. So on one, but let's just leave it at that. They're sacrificing themselves for, it's similar. There's some similarity there. Let's leave it at that. Of self-giving, self-sacrifice, just for the pleasure of the child, and without self-concern. So Guru Maharaj makes a distinction, and again, hear this in school. He'll say, he learned this from the Christian teachers in his school, where they discussed, of course, he applied it to Krishna conception. They discussed self-sacrifice and self-forgetfulness. And saying self-forgetfulness is higher than self-sacrifice. Because self-sacrifice, remember saying, yes, I will sacrifice myself for some particular end. Self-forgetfulness means no concept of that self-oblivion in the purest, beautiful sense of the term, that a total loss of self-consciousness, being so absorbed in the other. Not self-annihilation, but self-oblivion, self-forgetfulness. Not thinking, oh, and by this, what will come to me afterwards as a reward for this sort of self-sacrifice. So anyway, Guru Maharaj is telling that, saying that is their standard. And he's also saying in a very sweet way, and you're not on that standard. You may be very proud of yourself and very happy for, you know, this, what you've done, but there's work that remains to be done, to put it mildly. But then he said something interesting, that he's saying, now, why is it thought of as all risk and no gain, which immediately we go, well, I don't know if I want to sign up for that. Like here, sign the contract. You risk everything and you gain nothing. Yeah, put your name there and date it. He's saying, no, because, he said, this world you think is everything. And because you think this world is everything, you think, I'm risking everything. And because we're in a neophyte stage of the development of faith, or we think all this we're hearing about Krishna consciousness is theoretical, or it's abstract, it's talk, it's mythology, it can be any one of a number of things. So he's saying, from that perspective, you're saying, I'm risking everything, and it's uncertain what I'm gaining, really, from this. Anything. He's saying, but, remember, that's the plight of the neophyte. But, gradually making progress, as he said, when you move east, you're automatically withdrawing from west. It's simultaneous. So here, under the guidance of Sadhu Shastra Guru and Vaishnav, as we're making progress in Krishna conception, then this world starts losing its hold upon us. I mean, that's a soft way of putting it. The Bhagavatam is more dramatic. Bidite hridaya granti chidyante sarvasangshaya kiyante chasya karmani mayi driste akhilatmani. It's saying real full-blown Krishna conception cuts the knots that have a stranglehold on the heart. That, in other words, these knots that have a stranglehold on the heart, these ropes, these ties, these bonds, they're preventing the heart from expressing its natural love for Krishna, right? This natural possibility and tendency. It's presently knotted, tied, and saying, Krishna conception proper cuts the knots and releases this natural flow of the heart. So, saying, gradually, as this is taking place, and this world is losing its hold upon the progressive devotee, what does that mean to them? No, they're no longer concerned. What are the opinions? Before connection with Krishna consciousness, there's always some people with opinions we're very concerned with. Either our peer group, countrymen, things like that. If nothing else, maybe four or five people in your life, we're very concerned with what they think. So we make progress in Krishna consciousness. We'll see, actually, we're not concerned with what they think, and neither with what the peer group or the countrymen think. Who are these people? Even if they're near and dear to us, they're deluded. They have no proper conception. So we say, Vaishnavi Pratishta Tati Korunishna. Who do we care about? For us, we're told, the pragmatists say, we should concern ourselves with whose opinion matters. They mean the people of this world. For the spiritually progressive devotee, whose opinion matters means Vaishnav. Sadhu Shastra Guru Vaishnav. That we're concerned with. As Guru Maharaj is told in the Gaudiya Math times, people say so many things. He said, Gaudiya Math, they disbelieve everything out of hand. He said, but if you quoted some scripture, some sloka, then they would listen. And then they would see, is that a valid scripture, a valid sloka? And how far does it go in terms of the truth? That would catch their attention. Everything else they're dismissing. So Guru Maharaj is saying, as the hold of this, say, as nishta, or firm faith, your faith in Krishna consciousness starts developing roots, right? Like bhakti lata bead, seed, the roots, like we know in this world, when things start to grow, the roots go, right? When do they do the transplant? If they see, oh, the roots are sort of like, breaking the pot practically, then they realize this is ready to be transferred to the soil of the environment and it'll survive there. But in the beginning, they've got it in a greenhouse, a hothouse, and a very controlled environment so that it will grow and develop. That's why we have ashrams and ashram life, particularly in the beginning. It's very important for proper development. So that if someone does have to transfer to the soil, they can withstand that transfer and thrive. So Guru Maharaj is saying that as this transition takes place, Krishna consciousness is taking hold, the hold of the world is being released, then also this idiom or this sutra-like expression, all risk and no gain, he's saying, ultimately transitions to all gain and no risk when you realize I didn't risk anything. It was only my ego and a mental projection of attachment of things that have nothing to do with me, actually. The world and misconceived notions of self. He's saying, so in the end, all risk and no gain transitions into all gain and no risk. And now we come to the point. As Guru Maharaj has mentioned at different times, Saraswati Thakur also echoes the same sentiment in his purports of the Chaitanya Bhagavat. The spiritually progressive people, generally that means Brahman. Why are they called Brahmins? You could think about this in different ways. But it has the word Brahma in the name. Spirit means what other people have a hard time getting their heads around, or due to their natures, they don't entirely get it, or aren't willing to like make this transition. These people, they've got spiritual understanding in their DNA. This makes total sense to them. They're not bewildered. The spiritual nature is obvious to them. And it is thematically, it permeates everything that they do. So Guru Maharaj will mention, for example, before they would begin any activity, they chant the Rig Veda mantram. And Rig Veda is the original scripture in the world. Of all scriptures, this is the first one. Right? Bhagavatam is the ultimate expression, but Rig Veda is the first scripture ever. Right? And this mantra is primal within the Rig Veda. So how important is it? Om Tad Vishnu Paramam Padam Sada Pashanti Surayo Diviva Chaksuratatam Vishnur Yad Paramam Mama. And it's saying, the lotus feet of the Lord, Vishnu, Krishna, by extension Vishnu, said, are like the sun in the sky. What does the sun in the sky do? It gives illumination to everything. They're saying, the lotus feet of the Lord, the remembrance of the lotus feet of the Lord, they give illumination to anything and everything that we might do. So before we begin any activity, we wanted to proceed along those lines. You know, in other words, may the lotus feet of the Lord illumine our way, the way that we shall proceed. So you could say all of these things that I've just discussed on a certain level could be described as Krishna conscious theory, right? But here Guru Maharaj is saying, this theoretical knowledge is not enough. It's insufficient. It's good. We can understand these things, should understand these things. He's saying, but there has to be some practical application of the theory. He's not saying throw the theory away. He's saying apply the theory. So what does that mean? And the example he's giving here is so appropriate to help us understand. He's saying, like that of a child. A child, by nature, they think they know what's best for them, right? And anyone who is, you know, disagrees or is not, approve of what they want to do, it makes them unhappy, or they're thinking that person is cruel, mean, or whatever. Guru Maharaj's point is that he's saying the guardians of a child, the child loves themselves on a particular level, he's saying actually the guardians have more love and affection for the child than the child has for themselves. They are greater well-wishers of the child than the child is of themselves. Generally speaking, and when people get older, This is called, patronizing. Like we'll say, don't patronize me. You know, they object to it later. But in this example, no, patronizing is good for a child. The child's surrounded by well-wishing guardians who give that child guidance. And really what? How to grow naturally from the position of a child, from a minor, to achieve majority. In this connection, also, Srila Saraswati Thakur says that the mind is like an evil guardian. We can add this. As Guru Maharaj is talking about the affectionate guardian, Sadhu, Shastra, Guru, and Vaishnava, saying, our guardians, are they real or this is just some sort of theory? So we're in this plane, we're in our lives, we're in various karmic circumstances, and from time to time, if not all the time, we need some help. So Guru Maharaj is saying, theory is not enough. Then we have to take the proverbial leap of faith in believing that our guardians are real, they're above, they're watching us, they're more interested in our welfare than we are ourselves, and they can send grace to us. That's what he's telling us. Saraswati Thakur is reminding us that whom we think is our friend, the mind, or who I identify as ourselves, he's saying, is actually an evil guardian who does not have the interest of the minor at heart. Krishna deals with this in Bhagavad Gita to Arjuna, and he says, Udared atmanatmanam natmanam avasadet atmaiva hyatmano bandhur. Bandhu means friend. Atmaiva ripur. Ripu means enemy. Atmaiva ripur atmana. Saying your mind can be your best friend or your worst enemy. The mind, under the influence and following the direction of Sadhu, Shastra, and Guru, and Vaishnav, is the friend to the minor jiva and helps them achieve majority. Majority means where you can make competent decisions independently, not independent of divine authority, but means competent enough, having been acting under the influence of Sadhu, Shastra, and Guru Vaishnava, that they become reliable operators, agents. But the mind in opposition to Sadhu, Shastra, Guru, and Vaishnava is ripu, enemy, and does not have the minor jiva, her best interest at heart. And the classic stereotype is the fairy tale or the children's tale where the orphan child is put under the care of an evil guardian. Someone has left a lot of wealth to the child, and the evil guardian is trying to figure out how to rob the child of all the wealth by appearing to be loving, affectionate, caring, thoughtful. That's the situation. Robbing the minor of, what does that mean? To rob Jiva of her wealth. Her wealth is serving potential, dedicating potential. And rather telling Jiva, no, really what's in your best interest is expanding, activating and expanding your exploiting capacity, right? Not being theocentric, but egocentric. Self-assertion. Another word for self-assertion is pratishtha. The enemy of those on the path of pure devotion, kana kamini pratishtha. And what does he say? Saraswati Thakur in his own, Kanaka Kamini Pratishta Bhagini. Bhagini means witches. What is the sloka and the, maybe in Sanatana Shiksha about Bhukti Mukti Siddhi Kami Sakala Ashanta? No, what is that? There's another one. Can't think of it now. Pardon me? That's a good one, but that's not the one I'm thinking of. Means witches. Where bhukti and mukti are pisachi. Bhukti, yeah, like that, saying it. Bhukti and mukti are like two witches who are robbing Jiva of her wealth. And Guru Maharaj added to that, when the heart is being haunted or plagued by these two witches, he said, can you ask the Divine Lady, Bhakti Devi, offer her a seat there next to these two witches. That's how he expressed it once. So how to become free from that? Back to this practical application, Guru Maharaj is saying, so belief, our guardians are real. They are not imaginary. And if our necessity is genuine, then they will be gracious to us. That's what he's telling us. To apply this spiritual theory and put it into practice. My middle brother, he has grandchildren, he has children, he likes to play with children. And one of these things he does with them all the time is he gets them to trust him that they can leap and he will catch them. And I've seen them do this repeatedly. He gets their trust and they jump from something and he catches them because they believe in him that he will catch them. It's something like that. Going from theory to practice. The leap of faith. Hare Krishna. Anything else?
Well, a short question, maybe. Another one I will leave for next time. Question from China. How to become a devotee? Kent Maharaj gave practical advice to friends who are interested in China.
Through association. Like if someone said, I would like to become a drunkard. Can you give me some advice? And say, well, you could do a Google search. Right? And they can say, or it says the Wikipedia entry for drunkards. Drunkards are, you know, and then with many links. Then you can follow the links and say, drunkard, they behave like this, they have a general tendency to do, so many descriptions. Right? These are their activities. And you'll get some idea from that. Like we're talking here, theory and practice. But if you associate with drunkards, right, and take up their practices, right? Within 20 minutes, you'll understand what it is to be a drunkard. What they're feeling, you'll also be feeling. It's similar to that. So we should read about this. We read the scriptures, as we told, Sadhu Shastra Guru, revealed truth presented in the scriptures. But when we associate with devotees, then it becomes real. We're tasting what they're tasting. That is what this is about. What is the Bhagavatam? It says, Shukamukadam Ritradabhisham Yatam. Pibata Bhagavatam Rasamalayam Muhuraho Rasika Bubiba Vukaha Nigama Kapaturo Galitam Pram. Saying, so this fruit, Veda, we talked about the Vedas before, they're like a tree. Vedanta is the flower, the floral essence of that tree, and the flower gives way to the fruit, the nectarine fruit of the Kapaturo of Veda. You know, Sukadev, he's relishing that fruit. And what he's tasting, he's sharing with others. And then they're tasting what he's tasting. And this substance, unlike other substances that are compacted with taste, when someone tastes that, there's less taste, less, until it becomes tasteless, right? Punat-charita-charanam, chewing the chewed, where we're told, but here with the devotees, they're tasting, and this marvelous substance is such that it becomes enhanced by, it becomes more tasteful. The more it tastes it, the more tasteful it becomes. So we also recommend, on the basis of what's given by Mahaprabhu, the Nam Sankirtan. Sankirtan, many coming together to pursue Krishna consciousness together. So always association. And one thing we didn't get to, so that's the principle. Through association, we will improve. And anyone interested in pursuing Krishna consciousness should associate with devotees. But they will find those devotees are reading the scriptures, they're taking prasadam, they're observing the holy days, etc. But only because of Srivas Thakur's appearance day, where we didn't get the opportunity to say something, I can connect it to this question that, you know, Srivas Thakur, we hear is, such a great devotee in Mahaprabhu's pastimes. Those who just went to India, they went to Srivas Angam, means the house of Srivas Thakur, where the original kirtans were in Mahaprabhu's pastimes. It's near there that Jagannath Das Babaji Maharaj discovered some broken pieces of mridanga from the Kaji and could verify the location of Srivasangam. And there, even before Mahaprabhu, he and his brothers, and they all have names that begin with Sri, like Sri Nidhi, Sri, others, Srima, and they're all the Sri brothers, that they would have kirtans in their house. And this was disturbing to those of Asuric mentality in Navadvipa. And they were thinking, this Srivas Thakur is going to ruin everything, with this Nam Sankirtan. And I realized, he's going to save everyone with his Nam Sankirtan. In that sense, he's going to ruin it. Yeah, if ruin means destroy all things that are mundane, and by revealing what is genuinely spiritual, yes, that he will do. And it's that. But it's interesting. Because Mahaprabhu, he's showing different pastimes. As a child, we know, really some mischievous things. Because after all, deep down inside, Krishna is in there. And, he goes to the Ganga. One of the things he likes to do is to spit Ganga water on people. And they're going there to bathe, and they're like offering flowers, and prayers and stuff. And then when they open their eyes, there's Nimai Pandit going and spits water on them. They go, oh, I have to bathe in the Ganga again, They don't realize, how wonderful is that? The Ganga from the mouth, because normally Ganga comes from the lotus feet of the Lord. Now the Ganga is coming from the mouth of the Lord himself, but they're they come out, he spits water on them, they go back in, they come out, he spits more water on them, and they're thinking, this Nimai Pandit, he's, such a rascal, he's so naughty, and devotees, they'll be inside a house, before he's showing devotion, or that he's the Lord, he's concealing all these things. They'll be in some house somewhere, chanting like, Hari, Hari, praying to the Lord, and he'll come inside and go, what do you need? And they go, why are you here? He goes, why'd you call my name? And they go, I thought you called. No, we're praying to the Lord. All right. And so there are many things he's doing like that. Wonderful things, too. Like when his mother, when they usually cook with pots, even the pots for Vishnu, once they're black and burnt, these are clay pots, they would toss them. As mother finds them, he's in the midst of these pots, but sitting on, it's like a asan, and he's covered in black and soot from the pots, and his mother's saying, oh, now, why have you done this? These pots are not, they're contaminated. And he said, no. He's saying nothing related to the Lord is contaminated. Remember, while he's saying this, he's covered in black soot. But when Satchimata is looking at him, it's saying, think of how he's golden as Gauranga, but this black that's covering him now, she's noticing suddenly he looks like a brilliant blue sapphire. It looks like gold has been covered by a sapphire. And he's so, and he's exuding this inconceivably wonderful aroma. So it's hard for her to even concentrate on what he's saying, right? But anyway, so has these pastimes of a so-called arrogant scholar. When he meets with the teachers or the students, he takes a position. Whatever their position is, he defeats it. Then he takes that position and defeats it. And then he restores the original position. And they're all like, well. But they're thinking like, he's so beautiful, he's so intelligent, everything is perfect about him, except one thing, he's not a devotee of Krishna. Because from one point of view, he's not, and he's Krishna. So it's his plan, they're going, if he could just be, and what is the reason he's descended in the world, is to be a devotee of Krishna. And not just any devotee of Krishna, but the ultimate devotee of Krishna. But he has this brief period in the beginning where he's not showing devotion to Krishna and not revealing his divinity per se. So they're thinking, Gadadhar Pandit thinks, so beautiful, so wonderful, but not a devotee. And Srivast Thakur is also thinking like that. But then we're told that one day Srivast Thakur's walk, they encounter one another, and Srivast Thakur just starts laughing out loud for some inexplicable reason, saying, because we can understand, he's Narad Muni. He also, from time to time, what's going on in these pastimes? It comes to them, Yogamaya hides it, it's surfacing, diving, surfacing. He's laughing madly, seeing him, wishing him a long life. Mahaprabhu is joking with him, and then, and Srivast Thakur is thinking, you know, if you were only a devotee. But we can tell you, he's saying, it's time for you to start showing those pastimes. He knows, they know and don't know. So when he said, if only you were a devotee, he's saying, you know, it's time. And Mahaprabhu goes to Gaya, we know. He returns, and Achyutananda Maharaj once described his return. He said he came back as a God-intoxicated man. And now they see he's mad about the gopis and Krishna, and they start the kirtans with Nimai Pandit at Srivas Angam. And it's so wonderful. In the beginning, it's all private, indoors. And when these kirtans go on, no one can be in the kirtan who's not qualified. But we're told Srimas Thakur, his mother-in-law, they hear them, the sounds of divine ecstasy coming from the room, and it's naturally piquing the imagination, the interest of the people. So his mother-in-law is saying, like, who is not normally in the kirtans, there's a big, like, wicker rattan basket. She's thinking, I'll just turn it upside down and hide under there. Then I can be and maybe peek through the, you know, and see. And so imagine the Panchatattva are there. You know, as Guru Maharaj sometimes says, Nitai Gaur Gadadhar Advaita Srivas. Or, you know, Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Srivas Adi Gaur Bhaktivinoda. And Mahaprabhu, his usual ecstasy is not coming that evening. And he's saying, I don't know, something, you know, it's not coming, you know. And they're thinking, the devotees are wondering why, and they think, there's someone who's here who is not qualified. They're like, you know, it's like the last, is it I? You know. This is better than the Last Supper, actually. Infinitely better. with a happier ending. And so they're saying, is it I? And then they see the basket, and they open the basket, and they see under there's Srivast Thakur's mother-in-law, and we're talking, he drags her by the hair and throws her outside. But to show the kind of intensity he has, his level of surrender, Srupam Bib Brano Jagatatulyam Advaita Dvaita Prapanna Srivaso Janita Paramananda Gauri Ma, the sloka of Rupa Goswami, Prapanna Srivas. That one evening during the kirtan, he can see his wife and some ladies on the side, and they're like, they're crying, they're wailing, they're full of grief, and he leaves and comes in, what is the problem? And I say, your son died. And he tells them, he said, that may be. He said, but in the next room is Swayam Bhagavan, you know, Avatar Sar Gauranga Mahaprabhu, and he's in his divine bhav and madness of, you know, Radha Bhava Duti Subal, enveloped in the heart and hail of Radharani. He's in this deep ecstatic condition, and I will not let anything interfere with that. They're telling him, your son died. He's lying here on the floor, dead. And he's saying, nothing will interfere with Mahaprabhu. And Mahaprabhu, after that, as the night wears on, they'll have these kirtans like all night till the sunrise. And later, Mahaprabhu comes to find out, what is the disturbance? What happened? And when they tell him what happened, and that Srivast Thakur would not disturb him with this news, Mahaprabhu was saying, where are you going to find someone like that? Ever. Someone with this type of dedication and devotion. And he said in another place, if I say to Srimas, he will never, his family will never be in one. He said, if the goddess of fortune, Lakshmi Devi, right, the goddess of wealth, if she has to go begging, his family will never experience any sort of poverty. And Mahaprabhu said, where is that boy? And they take him to see the sun, and Mahaprabhu was like, get up. And the boy goes, it is, and he's actually, I believe, incarnation of the son of Chitraketu. Bhaktivinoda Thakur writes about this, and he said, it is only by your divine order that, you know, all the, he starts preaching the essence of, you know, that the soul's transmigrating from one form to another, that's also by your divine order. So only because of you does someone live in some family for a while, then they go to another place. So I came here by your order and your grace for some time. Now it's time for me. The boy, he's enlightening everybody. Just as the son of Chitraketu enlightened the wives of Chitraketu and everyone in a very beautiful way, this pastime occurs. But it's just one more example of how much Mahaprabhu loves Srivast Thakur and his family, his wife Malini, who Nityananda Prabhu, being the Avadut, sometimes he'd go to the show up at their house naked. And remember, Nityananda Prabhu is around, as Gurudev, like 7'7", or he's over 2 meters tall. And he's robust. And he would sometimes be totally naked and then sit on the lap of Srivast Thakur's wife, Malini, and suck her breast milk like a baby. and when my friend saw, like, oh, maybe some people can't digest this. So he took the kopeen of Nityananda, his underwear, and tore it into pieces and said, if you will wear this as a kavacha, an amulet, on your, you'll get sense control. There was Advaita and Srivas when Mahaprabhu said, I will dance as Adyashakti and Rukmini and at the house of Chandrasekhar. And he said, but only those whose senses are fully controlled can be in the audience. And Advaita and Srivas are like, oh, we so much wanted to go. And think, these are the greatest, Mahavishnu and Narad Muni, they say, we're not qualified, but we think we're qualified, right?
because I've been in a Krishna consciousness for
really. Mahavishnu and Narad Muni think they're not qualified. That their senses, their household, they're unqualified. So what does Mahaprabhu say? Oh, he said, if the two of you can't go, then it's going to be empty. Who can go? And they're still thinking, well, be that as it may, we're not qualified. And Mahaprabhu said, all right, I'm going to give you a special benediction that for the duration of the performance, your senses will be controlled. And they're like, Hare Krishna. Like, yes, by your mercy it's possible. Not because we're big devotees and we know this and we know that. No, by your grace, that we believe in you. If you say that, then we believe it. Otherwise, we don't believe it. And it was Srivas Thakur who teased the Hara Panchami Rasa Vichar from Srup Damodar about the comparative opulence of Vaikuntha compared to Goloka Vrindavan, and so many things. So Guru Maharaj has us singing his name, you know, Malini Srivasa Jai, every day of our lives. So he's so great, and the Panchatattva and these kirtans. Just, it's interesting, you see, we say in some, oh, began with, you know, Haridas and Advaita, yes, but Srivas and his brothers, then Panchatattva at Srivas Angam. Gurmars like to say, by the grace of the Panchatattva, this Maha Mantra is descended, where? Into the house of Srivas Thakur, and then it's extended from there. So, we would be remiss if we didn't take the opportunity to say something in the praise of Srivas Thakur. And what did Mahaprabhu say to Srivas? Like, oh, you want to become, if I could become a devotee? Well, with your association and the association of all these devotees, I know it's possible. So that's always the answer to the question. Anyone who's seriously interested in pursuing Krishna consciousness, you need the association of devotees. Sadhu Sangha Satovare, superior devotees, whenever possible, but also our peers. I'm speaking in a matter of terms because a real devotee, they won't think of the others as their peers, they'll think of them as superiors. But who we can generally say, our peer group, God brothers and God sisters, we need their association also to maintain our Krishna consciousness. Hare Krishna.